Hey guys, Mr. B here. On this video, we're going to go over the chapter 10.1 notes on the mole. So in chapter 10 here, we're going to be learning about different types of ways that we measure stuff in chemistry. There's a unit in particular we're going to learn about called the mole, which is very specific to chemistry. We'll also be talking about atoms, particles, grams, liters, stuff like that. So this chapter is going to be a bit math heavy. If you are someone who is not good with fraction math, then you'll need to do a little bit of brushing up on that. And if you remember dimensional analysis, which was something that we covered back earlier on, I think in chapter 2 or chapter 3, where we learned how to do conversions between different units, that's going to come up a lot in this chapter. So, all right, starting off here, it talks about how we could measure the amount of sand in this sand sculpture by counting each grain of sand, which obviously would be a very difficult thing to do. It would be a lot easier if we just weighed the sand and then tried to discover how much sand is there by weight. So in this chapter, you'll learn that chemists, and in chemistry in particular, a lot of times we will measure the amount of materials that we have by weight. Sometimes we'll do it by volume. Other times we will do it by actually counting individual particles. Okay, so there are some equations here that they give us at the very beginning. I try not to call them equations because if we understand how to do conversions, then this really isn't an equation. It's really just showing you the math work. But if you're an equations kind of person and you want to do some memorization, this could help you. So, all right. So let's talk about how do we measure matter in chemistry. Okay. So there's three main ways that we measure matter. We'll either measure by count, by mass, or by volume. And they give you three different pictures here that kind of show you items that would measure amount by count, mass, or volume. So a box of nails or screws here, for example, if you've ever gone to a hardware store, you typically buy these in boxes of a certain amount. So it could be a box of 50 or a box of 100 or a box of 200 or a box of 1,000. So that's usually buying by count. By mass, they show a bag of bird feed. Probably by this bag, it might be 5 pounds or 2 pounds or 3 pounds. That's usually by weight or by mass. And then by volume, they show here a can of paint, which you typically would buy paint in, again, volumes, right? 1 liter can or 2 liter or whatever. So we do the same thing in chemistry. Again, we measure different things based on count, mass, or volume. It depends, of course, on the material we're dealing with and what exactly we want to know about it. So before we jump into any chemistry related problems, we're going to take a look here at just an example of doing some conversions and understanding how we can use count, mass, and volume to measure amounts of stuff. Okay, so it says here, what is the mass of 90 average sized apples if one dozen of the apples has a mass of 2 kilograms? All right, so we're going to be doing this math work on paper here. So I'm going to be changing my camera up, but I'm going to first write down on my paper some information that they're giving us. Okay. So they are saying that we have 90 apples. And they're asking for the mass of these apples. So they want us to tell them what is the mass. And I believe the units they give us in the problem for mass is kilograms. And they tell us that one dozen apples, so one dozen apples is equal to or has a mass of 2 kilograms. So I'm going to write this as a fraction because this is what we call a conversion factor. It's basically telling us that these two things are equal to each other. Okay, one dozen apples is equal to 2 kilograms. So I'm going to write this as a fraction because we're going to need to use this in our problem to do some converting. Basically what we're doing is we're converting apples to kilograms. Okay, so I'm going to like kind of write out a little roadmap here of what we're going to do. So we're starting in the units of apples. And we need to convert into the units of kilograms. Now, they've given us one conversion factor here, which tells us how many kilograms are equal to a dozen apples. Now, we have just regular apples here to begin with. We don't have dozens of apples. Now, most of you probably know that one dozen is equal to 12. So this is a conversion factor that they're not telling us, but most of us probably know this off the top of our head. And this is very common in conversion problems where they may give you some information, but they may not give you every piece of information because some of the information is kind of like assumed that you know it, okay? So we also need this conversion factor here. So we are gonna convert from apples to dozens of apples to kilograms. Okay, so I'm just kind of mapping out the units here we're going to go through. So we're going to start with units of apples. I'm going to set up a conversion table. Basically, what a conversion table is where we set up fractions. We're going to be multiplying all the numbers on the top of our conversion table together. We're going to be dividing by all the numbers on the bottom of our conversion table. Okay, I just set it up like this way because I don't like to like write out a lot of multiply and divide symbols. It's just easier if you do it this way. It's a bit quicker in terms of writing information. So right now we're starting with apples, and we need to convert from apples to kilograms. Now, of these two conversion factors, only one of them has apples in it. Okay, now these have dozen apples, but just apples on its own is only this one. So we're going to use this conversion factor first. Remember that when we're converting, whatever unit we're starting with on the top of our fraction, we want to have on the bottom of our fraction down here. So we're going to take this fraction, and we're going to write it so that we have one dozen apples on the top and just 12 regular apples down on the bottom. Because then we see that we have apples and apples. So those two units will cancel out with each other and we'll be left in the units of dozen apples. Okay, now once I've used a conversion factor, I'm not going to use it again, so I'm just going to cross it off. So right now we've gone from apples to dozen apples because now this is the unit that we're in. We haven't canceled that yet. Now we want to go from dozen apples to kilograms. And this conversion factor has dozen apples and kilograms. So the unit of dozen apples, which is on the top of our fraction, we need to have that unit down here. So we're going to write one dozen apples down here. Okay, we're going to take this fraction and we're going to flip it around. So the one dozen, even though right now the way I've written it is on the top, it's actually going to be on the bottom. And the 2 kilograms, which is on the bottom, is going to be on the top. So up here, we're going to have 2 kilograms. Okay, so imagine I've just taken this conversion factor and I've moved it up to this spot and I just flipped it around so that the dozen apples is on bottom, 2 kilograms is on top. And we want to do that because, again, we want dozen apples to cancel. And that means that the only unit now that we have not canceled out is kilograms, which is the same unit that we want in our answer. So we know that we've done our math correctly. So now the last step here, of course, is to actually get a number and get an answer. So I'm going to pull up my calculator here just because I don't want to have to do this in my head. But we are going to take 90, okay, so we're going to take 90, multiply by 1, multiply by 2.0, divide by 12, divide by 1, and we're going to see what we get, okay? So 90 times 1 times 2.0, 90 times 1 times 2.0, divide by 12, divide by 1. Now, for those of you, of course, that know, you know, a lot about fractions and math, multiplying y by 1 and dividing by 1 isn't going to do anything. So if you want to skip the multiply by 1, divide by 1 part and just take 90 times 2, divide by 12, you can. But either way, we get an answer of 15 kilograms. Okay? So back in our problem here, what is the mass of 90 average-sized apples? If a dozen of them have a mass of 2 kilograms, it would be 15 kilograms. Okay, that would be our mass. So the mass would be 15 kilograms. All right, so that problem there was just a problem practicing converting. It had nothing to do with chemistry units or anything, which we are going to get into here in a second, but we first just needed to get a little bit of practice in reminding ourselves how dimensional analysis works. Okay. All right, so I'm going to skip past these problems here. I have a whole video of me going over the practice problems, so if you want help with those, you can watch that, but we're just going to talk about information. All right, moving on then, let's talk about some chemistry units. So what is a mole? So this unit, this word, a mole, sometimes can be a little bit confusing because, of course, it might sound like the animal, right? Like, oh, there's moles and they dig underground. Different thing, okay? This is a chemistry unit. It is not short for molecule. That's a whole different thing. So a mole of any substance contains Avogadro's number of representative particles. So basically what this is saying is one mole of anything is 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd representative particles. Basically one mole is this number, okay? Sort of like a dozen means 12, one mole means this giant number. This number has a name. It's called Avogadro's number because it was first discovered by an Italian scientist with the last name of Avogadro. But as for representative particles and what that refers to, a representative particle refers to the species present in a substance. So for example, if we're talking about a mole of carbon, carbon is an element. And so carbon or elements would exist as atoms. So one mole of carbon would be 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd carbon atoms. If we were talking about a mole of water, water is a molecular compound. So it exists as molecules. So one mole of water would be 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd molecules. If we're talking about like sodium chloride, which is an ionic compound, then that would exist as formula units. So one mole of salt or sodium chloride would be 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd formula units. Okay. This is important because the mole itself is just a number. It doesn't have a unit on it. The unit comes from the material that we're dealing with. So it would kind of be like, you know, again, it's like a dozen means 12, but you could have a dozen of a lot of different things. So, you know, if I went to the grocery store and I came home and my wife was like, oh, hey, what'd you get? And I was like, oh, yeah, I went to the grocery store and I picked up a dozen. She'd look at me and go like, a dozen what? A dozen donuts? A dozen eggs? A dozen roses because you love me so much, right? Like a dozen what? A dozen just means 12. Just like a mole means this number. So there's no unit on this number until you tell them what the material is you're dealing with, and then the unit will then appear, okay? So if I'm talking about a mole of any kind of element, I'm talking about atoms. If I'm talking about a mole of any kind of molecular compound, I'm talking about molecules. And if I'm talking about a mole of any kind of ionic compound, I'm talking about formula units, okay? So it's important to realize that. So one mole of any substance is 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd representative particles of that substance. It is the SI unit for measuring the amount of any kind of material or substance. So this is the international system of units. Basically, the mole is universal. Okay? It's used around the entire world by all scientists to measure amount of material. And again, this number, 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd, is called Avogadro's number because of the guy who came up with it. Okay. So this little chart here just kind of shows some of the different materials and how one mole is the same number, right? So if we had just regular atomic nitrogen, that would be atoms, and one mole of nitrogen would be this many atoms of nitrogen. Nitrogen gas, which is around in the atmosphere, is diatomic. So nitrogen is one of the Brinkelhoffs, which, by the way, that's going to come up again. So in case you don't remember the Brinkelhoffs, which I think was from chapter 8, section 1 or section 2. There are seven elements that exist in nature that are diatomic. I call them the Brinkelhoffs because if you put them all in order, it spells out Brinkelhoff. So it's bromine, iodine, nitrogen, chlorine, hydrogen, oxygen, and fluorine. Okay. And then technically sulfur is octaatomic. So it actually exists with eight of them. Basically what the saying is in nature, if you found regular bromine or iodine or nitrogen or chlorine or any of these elements in nature, you would never find them as one individual bromine atom or one individual oxygen atom. You'd always find two bromines bonded together floating around as a molecule, or two oxygens bonded together floating around as a molecule. Or in terms of sulfur, you'd have eight sulfurs bonded together moving around as a molecule, okay? So this actually is going to be really important going forward in this chapter and moving on into chemical reactions. So I'm going to probably talk about Brinkelhoffs and say that word a lot. This is what I'm referring to, okay? Anyway, so nitrogen gas in the air is diatomic, so it would exist as a molecule because there's two ends bonded together. So if you had a mole of nitrogen gas, you would have this many molecules of nitrogen. And inside of one molecule, there are two nitrogen atoms. So if you doubled this number, that's how many individual nitrogen atoms you would have, okay? So this little chart is kind of nice. It just kind of shows you the different units, the different kinds of substances. But again, one mole of all of them is still the same number. So, okay, so let's take a look at a practice problem here so we can get some more understanding under our belt. So it says magnesium is a light metal used in the manufacture of aircraft, automobile wheels, tools, and garden furniture. How many moles of magnesium is 1.25 times 10 to the 23rd atoms of magnesium. All right, so again, we're going to be switching over to paper here so we can do this problem out. I just can't write on my computer here. So let's switch my camera. So we have 1.25 times 10 to the 23rd atoms of magnesium. And they want us to tell them how many moles is that? So how many moles of magnesium is that? Okay. Now the conversion factor we want to use here is Avogadro's number. So 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd particles of anything. In this case, the particles we're dealing with are atoms of magnesium. Is equal to 1 mole of magnesium. Okay, so this is our conversion factor. This is the only conversion factor we need because we are going from atoms to moles. And this conversion factor has both of those units in it. So let's set up a conversion table. Since I'm starting with atoms of magnesium, the 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd atoms of magnesium needs to go on the bottom of my fraction because I want that unit to cancel out. And on the top of my fraction will be 1 mole of magnesium, okay? So we'll see that this is just a very simple one-step conversion. We're gonna take 1.25 times 10 to the 23rd, and we're going to divide that by 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd. All right, so on my calculator, and I'll even show you here, okay? On the calculator, there's this little double E button. Okay, that, you can hit that to do times 10. So I'm gonna go because we want to start with this. So we're gonna go, I'll even put it here so you can see it. So we're gonna go 1.25 double E 23 equals, okay? So it'll say 1.25 times 10 to the 23rd. And we're going to, we'll times it by one, just because there's one up top. And then we're going to divide that by 6.02 and then double E 23 equals, okay? And there's our answer. We are gonna have to remember significant figures, which we haven't done for a while. So in this case, 1.25 has three significant figures. So I'm gonna round this to 0.20 and then the seven will round up to an eight. So this would be 0.208 moles of magnesium as my final answer, okay? So 0.208 moles of magnesium would be in this many atoms of magnesium. All right, so moving on, let's take a look at the next section here. Again, I'm skipping past all these problems because I have a video of me going over them. So if you wanna watch that, you can go and do that on your own time. All right, so basically that problem was going from atoms to moles. Now we're just going to look at going the other way around, which is going from moles to particles, okay? So here's another problem, pretty much very similar to the previous one, but now we're going to be going backwards. So it says propane gas is used for cooking and heating. How many atoms are in 2.12 moles of propane? All right, so again, let's switch back to our paper. So we have 2.12 moles of propane, which is C3H8. And they want us to tell them how many atoms is that. All right, so this problem is actually a little bit tricky, but first off, let's think about what the first conversion is. So we're going from moles to atoms, and atoms is a type of particle. So we're definitely gonna need to use Avogadro's number to do our first conversion. So 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd. Now the question here is, what is the unit that goes on this, right? We're dealing with propane, C3H8. What kind of compound is this, right? This is a molecular compound. So this unit that goes on here is gonna be molecules, okay? Because we are dealing with a molecular compound. So this is molecules of C3H8 for every 1 mole of C3H8. So here's our first conversion factor, okay? 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd molecules of C3H8 is 1 mole of C3H8. Now here's where this problem gets a little tricky. If you look at what they want us to find, they want us to calculate atoms. But the conversion factor we just wrote out has the unit of molecules. So what do we do? Well, remember that by definition, a molecule is two or more atoms that are covalently bonded together, right? So one molecule of C3H8, you can ask yourself, how many atoms are in one molecule of C3H8? You can just count them up. There's 11. There's 3 carbon atoms and 8 hydrogen atoms. So in one molecule of C3H8, there are 11 atoms. So this is actually going to be a two-step problem. Okay. This second conversion factor we just wrote out, they didn't give that to us, but it's pretty easy to determine just by looking at the chemical formula. So this is where it's important to understand the units that go on Avogadro's number. Otherwise, you might have just thought that this was atoms and then done one conversion and been done and gotten it wrong. So let's set up our conversion table. We're starting with moles of C3H8. If we look at these two conversion factors, this one has moles in it. So we're going to use that one first. We'll put one mole of C3H8 down on the bottom of our conversion. So we want to cancel that unit out. We'll put 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd molecules on the top. Okay, so we see that moles of C3H8 will cancel with moles of C3H8. Once we've used that conversion factor, we can cross it off. We're not going to use it again. Now we are in the units of molecules. We need to get into atoms, and this conversion here has molecules and atoms. So we're going to, remember, we have molecules here. So we're going to put down on the bottom, for every one molecule, there are 11 atoms. Okay, so now molecules will cancel, and we'll be left in the unit of atoms, which is exactly what our answer wants. So now we just need to do the math. Again, I will pull my calculator out here, and I'll show you the work. Okay, so we're going to take 2.12 times 6.02 E23 equals times 11 equals, and then we can divide by 1 and divide by 1 if you want to, but that's not going to change the value of the number because it's just dividing by 1. So we get 1.40 and all this other stuff. Remember significant figures. Here we started with 2.12. That has 3 significant figures, so we're going to round this to 3 sig figs. So we're going to go 1.40 times 10 to the 25th. Okay, that's what the E means. So 1.40 times 10 to the 25th. That is our final answer for how many atoms there would be total in 2.12 moles of propane. All right, cool. So let's go back to our notes here. There's some more practice problems here for you. We are going to, of course, skip past these. There's a video of me going over those, so you can look at those later. All right, so that dealt with moles and particles. But of course, when we go into the chem lab and we do a lot of measuring and stuff like that, we typically don't measure the amount of material in atoms or molecules, right? We use scales, and a scale gives you a mass in grams. So the question then is, how can we relate moles or particles to mass or grams? And there's a way that we can do that. So on the periodic table, the atomic mass of any element can be expressed in the number of grams of that element per one mole, okay? So the atomic mass of an element on the periodic table is also what we call molar mass. Now, you might be confused or not remember what is atomic mass on the periodic table. So real quick, I'm just going to draw you out a little picture to kind of show you what the molar mass of an element would look like on the periodic table, okay? So let's say, for example, we looked at carbon. On the periodic table, right, all these elements have these big boxes. And there's usually an element symbol like this. Maybe in the upper corner, there's like a number up here, which gives us the atomic number. That's the number of protons that are in the nucleus. And then down below, there's usually a number that's like given as a decimal, okay? This number down here, this is our atomic mass. So this is what we're talking about when we're talking about atomic mass of any element. So this is usually given in atomic mass units, or AMUs. However, we also can put this in the units of number of grams per mole. So what this is saying is, is that if I had 12.011 grams of carbon, that would be equal to 1 mole of carbon atoms. Okay, that's exactly what this is saying. So this is also what we call molar mass. So we're going to use the periodic table quite a bit, because if we want to know how many grams does a certain element weigh, or how many grams does a mole of any element weigh, we can just look on the periodic table, look at the atomic mass, and know that that also is a molar mass. It tells us how many grams of that element would be 1 mole of that element. Okay, so very important little piece of information we're going to use quite a lot here. So they have a picture here just to show you some other elements. So this would be 1 mole. There's 1 mole of carbon atoms, 1 mole of sulfur atoms, 1 mole of mercury atoms, and 1 mole of iron atoms. Okay, so basically in every single one of these samples, you'll notice that there's exactly 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd particles. But each one weighs a different amount, right? Carbon weighs about 12 grams, sulfur is about 32 grams, mercury is much heavier at about 200 grams, and iron is about 56 grams. That's because each of these elements, the size of the atom is different. So carbon, being the smallest of all these elements, has the smallest atom. So 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd carbon atoms wouldn't weigh that much because each one is relatively small, right? So you can kind of think of these as like marbles. Whereas mercury is very, very heavy. One atom of mercury is much bigger and much heavier than one atom of carbon. So if you had the same amount of mercury atoms, they're going to weigh way more. So it's kind of like marbles compared to like bowling balls, okay? Much, much bigger. The difference, though, also is that mercury is a liquid. So it's the atoms are much more compressible. They kind of squeeze on top of each other, which is why that they don't take up that much space. Sulfur is lighter than mercury is, but it's a solid. So there's air between all the particles. They kind of take up more volume and they don't sit so nicely. Iron is a heavier atom than sulfur is, but iron being a metal, metals are very good at packing themselves in very well. So again, they are very good at optimizing their space, which is why the pile of iron atoms here doesn't look like it's as much as the sulfur, when in reality it's the same amount and they're heavier, but they pack themselves in better. So they don't take as much volume up. All right, so this little chart here just kind of goes over looking at the different types of units and stuff. So one carbon atom has a mass of about 12 AMUs. One hydrogen atom has a mass of about 1 AMU. The ratio, if you were to take a carbon to a hydrogen, the ratio would be 12 to 1. If you have two carbon atoms and two hydrogen atoms, you now have 24 AMUs for mass and 2 AMUs for hydrogen, but the ratio is still 12 to 1. Right, so even if you like increase the number of atoms or particles you have up to Avogadro's numbers worth this many, the ratio is still 12 to 1. So this is how we know that atoms, when they bond together to make molecules, they do so in whole number ratios, and it's always the same all the time. Okay, this is a little bit of chemical theory there, but okay. So last little section here. This is how can we calculate the mass of 1 mole of a compound. So we just looking at the mass of 1 mole of an element, but what if we have a compound, right? I mean, compounds have multiple elements bonded together. Can we still find the mass of that? Yeah, it's actually pretty simple. So to find the molar mass of a compound, first we're going to find the number of grams of each element. So we're going to find the molar mass of each element. Then we're going to add all of them together to get our molar mass for the whole compound, okay? So here's an example here. Let's say we wanted to find the mass, the molar mass of SO3. So that is how many grams does 1 mole of SO3 molecules weigh? Now they're telling us here that it's 80.1 grams. How they get that? So sulfur on the periodic table has a mass of about 32.1 AMUs. So they're taking one mass of sulfur, 32.1. Okay, that's the atomic mass of sulfur. You can find it on the periodic table. Plus the mass of 3 oxygen atoms. Oxygen has a mass of about 16 AMUs. So one sulfur, 32.1, plus 16 from one oxygen atom, plus 16 from another oxygen atom, plus 16 from the third oxygen atom. You add all of those together, you get 80.1 atomic mass units, which we know that this can be converted into basically 80.1 grams of this material would be 1 mole of that material. Okay, so finding molar mass from a compound is pretty simple. You're just going to do some basic addition, find some atomic masses on the periodic table, and add them together. They have another picture here of some other compounds and their molar masses. We're just going to skip past that. Take a look at this last, sample problem, and then I think the rest of this is just practice problems for you to do on your own. And again, there's a video of me going over that. All right, so it says the decomposition of hydrogen peroxide, H2O2, provides sufficient energy to launch a rocket. What is the molar mass of hydrogen peroxide? All right, so this is pretty simple. Again, I'm going to switch back to my paper, though. So we have H2O2, okay? And all we're going to do is we're going to add these masses together. Now, I don't have a periodic table here in front of me and on the screen. You'll definitely want one to do this, but I know these masses off the top of my head, so just take my word for it that this is a mass, but if you're not sure, you can always look it up on the periodic table, okay? So hydrogen has a mass of about 1 gram, and I'm just going to round to whole numbers here. You don't need to use all the decimals. If you really want to be precise, you can. I'm just going to round to whole numbers to make it easier, okay? So hydrogen has a mass of about 1 gram, so H 2 is about 1 gram. We're going to times that by 2, of course, because there are two hydrogens here. So this is about 2 grams from the two hydrogens. Oxygen, O2. Oxygen has a mass of about 16 grams. Again, there are two of them in this compound, so we need to multiply this by 2. So this gives us about 32 grams from the oxygens. And then if we add these together, 32 plus 2 grams, we get 34 grams. So the molar mass of H2O2 would be about 34 grams per 1 mole. Okay, so 1 mole of hydrogen peroxide would weigh about 34 grams. And that's it. That's how we find our molar mass. Okay, very simple. We're just adding some numbers together. Again, you'll need to find these molar masses on the periodic table. I know them off the top of my head, but you'll want to use a periodic table because you probably don't know them. Okay, all right. So, I believe that was the last little bit of information here. There are some other sample problems and practice for you to go over, but again, I have a video of me going over that, so you can watch that if you need any more help. All right, guys, that's it for this section, and I will see you in the next one, chapter 10.2. Bye.